without even reading the section, because the section has been worded in a very, very different way. To understand that, we need to understand something about the armed forces. Do you think they deserve it? If yes, why? Why do you think? See, I was on February 14th, what happened this time? Yes, Pulwama attack. So, incidentally, I was in Kashmir, right? So, and I was in Pulwama. So the thing is, I consider myself very lucky to be here because I saw what happened there. So I was just going on the road. I passed the Jawans, by the way, right? We were somewhere near close by. There was some, you know, archaeological site. We finished that and we were, you know, what do you say, driving right opposite them. I mean, this was a road and right opposite the other way we are going. We passed them. There was the entire battalion of, you know, so many 20-25 vehicles, the convoy. And one or two, what do you say, vans, they were actually singing happily, right? And it was, we passed them and we just stopped by a what do you say, hotel to have lunch. And exactly 8 minutes after we passed, we heard the explosion. So actually we may have passed the terrorist also, because if I actually think about it, there was vaguely, I remember a van standing right opposite the junction. So that van may have been the terrorist van. And if you see the terrorist there, he ensured that all the civilians at least were all moved, and he attacked only the Jawans. Now it's a very, very, I did not understand this entire Kashmir issue until I actually went there. It's a beautiful, beautiful place. So even once in your life, at least, you should go. The thing is, it's a different country. I'm not kidding. That they treat Indians not as Indians. They don't want Pakistan. They don't want India. They want their own separate country. So the thing is, I just missed death by actually 8 minutes. So I know this year it happened to me. So I actually, you know, fell in love with life after what happened to us, because we just missed it by a whisker. It was just 8 minutes. So imagine in the morning, 8 minutes early if we had left, or 8 minutes something somewhere if we had gotten delayed. Think about it. Or rather 8 minutes early if we left somewhere. So it's all destiny. And I saw many Jawans there laughing, smiling, and it was all wiped out with one explosion. And the thing is, before that, 2 days ago, we were in Srinagar and then we heard gunshots, gunfire. And the people there, like, it's like normal. It's like normal, like we have this crackers, no, that gun. It's like that's very normal for them. They do not work almost, the Kashmir is closed almost 190 to 200 days a year because of some curfew, because of, and it's very, very normal for them. And whether they sell stuff beyond MRP, nothing. They sell the normal rate only. I really don't know how they make their money, how they make their living. So it's like extremely harsh conditions, extremely loving people towards the tourists, extremely loving. But after the Pulwama attack, I remember that we were going through the streets just for a walk, just to understand how the culture is. Two small kids, 7-year-old kids, 7, 8, 10-year-old maximum, they came with the, with, you know, their faces covered, and they said, "You please leave now. Things are going to get very dicey now." Why? Because our fools here in Bihar and other places, our fools, what did they do? They hit some Kashmiri. If you remember, just after the Pulwama attack, they attacked a Kashmiri. They attacked Kashmiris across the country. And then what happened? Those guys want to retaliate. They respect tourists a lot. Kashmir is actually running because of tourism. And after the Pulwama attack, we had hired a local guide, because without guides you cannot survive there. So the guide said, my 29 foreign tourists, 29 separate trips that I have had cancelled. So his entire 1 year earning gone because of one attack. For them, normal gunshots, etc., like very, very normal. It's baffling. If you have to actually go there to see it, to believe it actually. We will be like, if anybody hits, you know, gun here, means the 10 days you won't come this side. Correct? Watal Nagras and 20 days band they'll do. Correct? There, it's like very normal. So we were passing by, there was a bomb explosion in the main chowk in Srinagar. He said, yeah, it's normal, normal, no problem. The driver was telling during his childhood, he aramse used to walk around when two people were actually having a gunfight battle. It's very, very normal. But Pulwama was something different. And after that, as I told you, there was tension across the country. And those two kids became 10 kids slowly. And they started following us. They said, you please leave immediately. So the only safest place in Kashmir is the mosque. So we ran to the mosque. We ran to the mosque and then we came down from the mosque. The moment we put our our leg on the last step of the mosque, when we got down, they pelted stones at us. And believe it or not, we are in India, and they said, India, go back. I'm not kidding. So the thing is, they just want to be left alone. It's a beautiful place. I will definitely go again. You should definitely go also once in your life. But if you see every 50 meters, every 100 meters, there's a Jawan standing guard, because it is our country. It is unbelievable. If you go walking also, every 100 meters, there'll be a Jawan who will be smiling at you and you can talk to him, right? And every 50 meters in the main street, there'll be a Jawan. Every 100 meters, there'll be a Jawan with obviously all artillery. That's how it is. You probably would never have seen. Here our mamas will be there, right? Traffic mamas, arms are standing. There it's like very, very normal. Completely attired, full attire, full artillery, everything. Every 100 meters. It's like you're some other country, honestly speaking. So the thing is, it is not easy to just lay your life for the country. I asked this question, how many of you after CA would want a career in the army? Be honest. I actually will write down the names. I've taught almost 9,000 students now, and I just have some 10 names. Including me, I don't have the guts to do it. Will you? Like after, now when I say army, I'm not saying join the, what do you say, army as a Jawan, as a soldier. Everybody is a soldier there. What I meant was not in the battlefield. There are a lot of accounts officers needed. Chartered accountants are needed to be stationed in all these base camps. And if you know in Uri, that's what happened. The base camp only was attacked. And 2-3 accounts officers also died. So anything can happen anytime. Like that, anything can happen anytime, anywhere to us. But the thing is, there, death is staring at your face. That's the biggest thing. So how many of us are ready to face death? Agree to leave the families and face death. It is not an easy thing to leave one's family and go there, and where death can come anytime, any moment. So even there, one of the Jawans got killed. You see the newspaper, it's so normal now. 3 Jawans killed in the attack. And there it's very normal. 1 or 2 deaths a day is very normal there in Kashmir. So they are already attuned to the fact that people will die. So it's a very baffling scenario. We are here in the comfort of our state, and here down south or even the other parts of North India, we're very, very safe. But if you actually go there, even the public don't know whether they'll come back alive or not. We went to my dad's friend's house for dinner, and she said, I'm very sorry today. This food is cooked without onions because there was no onion in the market. Market is closed since 10 days. So they put their rations almost around 1 month in advance, they store. And they she didn't have chili. So he said, I'm sorry, it's bland little. Chilies are not available. So now if you see those conditions, we will respect. Here next cross if I go, some 10 people will be selling chilies in 100 meters. So if you see, then when we go and see the adversity there, we tend to respect. You feel suffocated to live there even for 2 days. But as much as that, you will also respect that it is actually your own country. Your country in which the people feel that they are not Indians, and they actually tell Indians go back. And they pelted stones at us only because the other fools in our country are retaliated. They have immense respect for the tourists there. They will not do anything to the tourists. But those are small kids. And when the small kids tried pelting, the others chased them away. That's the best part. And one person who was there since almost 25 years doing some savouries he creates, he came and apologized. He said, I'm very, very sorry. Please visit again. This is not what is done always. But there are tensions across the country because people are attacking Kashmiris. So when I ask this question, how many of you will join the army? It is very, very few people who, as I told you, of 9,000 students, only 9 students I have. And I told them that I am going to ensure that I'll check it simply you can't tell, you know, because of, you know, national anthem, Vande Mataram, in full josh, you can't tell, I'll join the army. It's not easy. Joining the army is giving your life to the country for the next, whatever, 10-15 years. And you won't even know whether you will be alive or not at the end of it. You can die in 3 months, 4 months and all those things. My uncle in first class, I told you, he was in the army. He retired recently. So my aunt was telling me that I did not know that every day he would come whether in a body bag or alive. My aunt has not seen my uncle for almost 1 month, 2 months like that, despite staying together. Because he would go in the morning and come back late night only to just sleep for like 1 or 2 hours, or sometimes not come back at all. Now, what happened was I was in Mangalore teaching the ICI students. So generally I go to Mangalore. And then when I came back, one day I was just flying back. So that day, the day of the flight, it was evening, late evening. It was a 5:30, 6 o'clock flight. I was very happy that day because I had taught almost 27 days on the trot. That is full day. Morning 8 a.m. to almost 8 p.m. So it's a wonderful feeling that you have achieved. That's what I was thinking. So around 27 days I taught, and then I had that sense of achievement. What did I teach? Same, company law. It was CA final. And it was in the AC room, aram se, no tension. 27 days continuous on the trot. So I had that sense of achievement while going back to Bangalore. So I was in the lounge, Mangalore airport lounge. Suddenly I saw a friend, a very, very old friend. Now I will not be taking names because later I came to know we should not take names. So that friend of mine, she's my childhood friend. I had not seen her since over 20 years, around 20 years. She was my childhood school friend. So I was very happy to see her. But I knew that she was in Australia. So I was wondering, why is she here in Mangalore of all places? So she was also shocked to see me. I was also shocked to see her. And I knew that her husband was in the army. So I said, how in Mangalore of all the places? So she said, no, my husband is also here. Then I met the husband. So the thing is, they had just 1 day off. She is in Australia. He is in somewhere in, obviously, in the army. Again, he told me we should not discuss the place where they are stationed. It's a secret thing. Even he didn't tell me. But he said somewhere in the north, somewhere in the mountains, he told. So the thing is, we met. And the thing is, they just had 1 day off, and her passport was getting expired. They tried all their passport seva kendra in Bangalore. Obviously, it was all full. Only Mangalore was there, 1 day slot. That's why they had come to Mangalore on the only day that they actually met. So we got to talking. The next 40 minutes, whatever happened, will remain with me for the rest of my life. That guy was so chilled out. He's my same age, by the way. He was so, maybe like 3-4 years older than me, I think. But he was so chilled out, you know, with life. I asked him a question, how is it in the army? He's some engineer. So what he does is, he tests the aircrafts. So before the aircrafts leave, he tests them. So I said, how do you do your tests? He said, every day we'll do all the necessary, all the needful, and then we'll have to sit behind the pilot and go. The testing there is sitting behind the pilot and actually flying, imagine. I said, what if something goes wrong? Something goes wrong means we die. So coolly is telling. Something goes wrong means something will go wrong. We'll ensure that it will not. Our plane will not crash land in any, civilian area. That we will have to ensure. I said, is there any mechanism of testing? No. We'll have to do our work, sit behind the pilot and just pray that we will not die. Simple. So coolly is Aram se telling. I am sitting there thinking of 27 days I taught. And this fellow is talking about death, Aram se, right? You know, I will have to die. Then I said, I was patrolling this area. I said, patrolling? Why are you patrolling? He said, boss, in the army, everybody has to do everything. So I may be an engineer here, but there in the army, I have to do everything. I have to do night patrolling. I have to be a soldier. I have to do anything that they ask of me. It's not that an engineer means I'll be sitting in the comfort of the camp. No, I have to patrol. He has seen his own friend die. He was part of all the terrorist attacks. Again, I'm not supposed to name it. All the major terrorist attacks that happened last 1 or 2 years, you know which are the major attacks, he was all part of it. And he has seen his own friend die right before his eyes. Correct? So the thing is, you know why Uri happened. It's in retaliation of some other thing. So he was a part of all those things. He was in that same base camp. So the thing is, it is crazy to see. He was like, yeah, it's fine. I said, don't you feel scared? I said, what is there, man? Nothing. So coolly he's telling, you know, 40-45 minutes I spoke to him, And then I realized that you should understand that my friend, who is a normal human being like you and I, she got married to this army man, so she didn't understand that the first thing that they love is not the wife. The first thing that they love is not the parents, it is the country. So she said, to understand that, I took 2 years. They are happily married since 3-4 years now. She said, it took me 2 years. So generally when you are married, you are first welcomed into the family. There in army, there is no separate for Muslim separate, Hindu separate, nothing. It's all part of a platoon. In Hindi, it's called Paltan. So you are part of that family. So they were into some Paltan, obviously. So they'll welcome. So first the main head of the Paltan will come and all the friends will come and they'll rag the husband and wife and they'll have obviously a proper dinner for them, only for them, hosting them, welcoming them into the family. So she was telling that at that particular meeting, they met this guy's best friend for 20-25 years, the husband's best friend 20-25 years, very, very thick friends. Then that's how they joined the army. When they joined the army, he was telling that the first 2 years at the National Defense Academy was the worst years of his life as well as the best years of his life. After he finished his training, straight after engineering he went to the army. After he finished his training, when he got down from the train, his father couldn't recognize him. His dad went past him searching for his son. His dad had come there to search for his son, welcome his son. This guy was right standing right there, he went past him. He had become lanky, fit of course, but very thin, completely dark he had become because of the rigorous training. You have watched the movie Lakshya. All that training is apparently nothing. Whatever they have shown is nothing compared to what they actually do. Anyway, so now he was telling me about his best friend. Now my friend was telling me about the husband's best friend. They just met 25 years of friendship. And they also met the main head of the entire Paltan. They laughed about it. They had fun. They have played cards. They had super fun. 2 days later, both died. Both the head and the best friend. And the best friend obviously was married and the wife was 8 months pregnant. So the thing is, she couldn't take it, my friend. She started wailing, crying, because for the first time, a normal human being, you just go into this army thing, you're feeling very welcomed at the presence of so many nice people. You just met that person 2 days ago, you played cards with them, the main head of the platoon as well as the best friend, and 2 days later they are not there. So she was wailing, she didn't know what to do. Then she went to the husband, in search of the husband in that same area. That husband was aram se playing cards. He was playing cards along with all his friends. She said, your best friend just died. He said, yes, I know, no problem. Why are you playing cards? He said, in his memory, because he loved cards. He said, won't you cry? He said, not here. I'm here to serve my country. I'm not going to cry here. If I cry, I'll probably go to the restroom and I'll do it everything in private, not here. Here I have to be strong. So my friend lost it. She said, I cannot stay with you. I cannot stay with a human being who has no emotion. He said, we are trained to be like this. So because tomorrow I may also die and my friends will play whatever I like. Because both that main head and the best friend liked cards. So the entire battalion, they were playing the cards. And when she went there running, crying, they said, that is what a death to have. Why are you crying? If anybody has to die, he has to die like that. I mean, that mindset, tell me guys, do any of us have? No. I don't have for sure. I'm sure even you don't have. So as I told you, 9,000 students that I had trained, only 9 students honestly want to become. But does it mean the rest of us are cowards? No. But the thing is, they are telling, at least rest of you, try to respect the Indian armed forces. Whatever calamity is there, first thing you'll call the army. Some bridge collapse happened in Mumbai, first thing army went. Yesterday in Meghalaya, cave explanation, something happened. Their miners were trapped. First thing they called was the army. In Chennai recently, who was Chennai flood, Kerala floods, who were called army. So if you see, the Indian army is a wonderful place. So that 40 minutes that I actually met him was a slap on my face, a sudden realization saying that what you are doing is not at all great. So destiny made me meet those guys in a random place. So she couldn't take it up for 1 or 2 years. So she said, I'll go mental if I stay with you, because I am an emotional person. Anybody is emotional, but your lack of emotion, because of the training that you have got, I cannot stay. I love you so much. Can I just go and work somewhere? He said, please, please go. That's why she's staying in. They're happily married, but she's staying in Australia. She's working there, and this guy is here across. So that one day, he keeps texting me. He said, how is your work and all that, he asked me. I said, so show me your workplace, he asked me one day. So I took a selfie with the students and sent him. Then he sent me, this is my workplace. All snow-clad mountains around. He said, that's my workplace. And every 10 days, it keeps changing. And he says, it coolly, he said, death can come any time, so we have to be ready. It's all okay, no problem. So that ability to face death is something which is incredible. And now in that mindset, don't you think so? We should obviously respect the armed forces. Yes. So if you see that respect is not generally there, these politician fellows recently had a debate whether that one egg is enough for them or 2 eggs. One egg is too much, 2 eggs is too much for them. One egg is enough. Why should they have eggs? Why should they have 2 to 3? Let them have just one. In Siachen Glacier, which is the highest point where both the armies are protecting the respective countries, there the people die because of the weather, inclement weather. More than the enemy there is the weather. And we don't have proper protective clothing also. We don't manufacture our own guns. It is shameful, right? India doesn't manufacture its own guns. Even if it does, it's like the old, your grandfather used to have a double barrel gun. That gun is what we manufacture. We import, shamelessly import stuff from other countries. Our defense budget is, so much. But what is the point when there is no indigenously produced stuff? That's why if you see the Rafael deal, also same thing happened. We're importing aircrafts. When would we, Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, when will it produce its own jets is the question. So if you see, they are doing it, but then you see no that Abhinandan, what did he do? He knocked down a which jet? Yeah, F-21, F-16. He knocked it down with his MiG-21. He's an old grandfather, plane. So we have the skill, but not the stuff to do it. That's unfortunate. But the thing is, least we can do is respect our armed forces. So it was destiny that I met him at a random place called Mangalore for 45 minutes to show my place. He told me that what I am, I mean, he told me in the sense, I learned from him that what I was doing was nothing great. Teaching some 40, torturing 50, 60 people in a classroom for 27 days from morning till evening in the comfort of the AC is nothing great, honestly speaking, compared to what they do. And it was really destiny that suddenly I saw my friend and suddenly I had to meet, and 40 minutes or 50 minutes I had to spend. Both of us were going to Bangalore on different flights. It is pure destiny where I was shown my place indirectly, though he didn't mean to, but that's what happened. So the thing is, I'll just play you a video now. This is, I mean, rather than me talking, it's better if obviously an army man talks. This video is very necessary for us to understand Section 183. You like this video. So this is what the Indian Army does. So you like it 100%. Let's see. You've seen TEDx talks, you've heard TEDx. There is a TEDx talk. It's a very good speech by Captain Raghuram. I don't know if you have watched it, but watch it. It's really worth it.
If there's one institution in this country which has been largely apolitical, largely incorruptible, and which has delivered each time that they've been called out, you would agree, most of you would agree, that it's the Indian Armed Forces. Whether it's an external aggression, internal security problems, or aid to civil authorities, as what's going on right now in Chennai, our soldiers have always been there. Troops in combat have a very, very tough situations at times. Just so you know, that when we have to attack a post of a section held by a section of 10 men, the ratio of attackers to defenders is 1:4, which means to attack a section, you have to launch an attack with a platoon of 40 people. In the mountains, this ratio changes from 1:4 to 1:10. Because if you have a section of 10 men holding a post, a company minus of 100 have to launch the attack, because only then about 10 or 15 will reach on top. That's our attrition rate, 80 to 90% attrition. And unlike corporates, our attrition is permanent. Like most mistakes in the army, our mistakes come home in body bags. So when these 100 men are lined up and they're looking to the right and their left, they know that out of the 100 here who begin the assault, only a handful will see the end of that day. Most of them would be dead, and many of them would be worse than dead, handicapped, amputees. And yet, they will write their last letters to their families, to their parents, to their unborn children at times. They will heft their battle packs, cock up their rifles, roar the war cry of their platoon, and they will launch that attack. A question I ask very often in B schools is, why do our soldiers do this? And across B schools, from the young students, from the cream of our country, the future leaders, the answers that I get is because of patriotism, because of the national flag, because of the uniform. They do it for us. That's what they tell. And that sounds very nice and warm and fuzzy inside. Until I put up the map of India and ask a very fair question. I ask them a question that if you believe your army is doing it for you, where are they doing it? I ask them, where is Kargil, where is Siachen, or where is any one of the hundreds of battlefields where our soldiers have fought? And now something really funny happens. Bright kids who can point out San Jose, San Francisco from the world map struggle to point out where is Siachen, where we have been fighting for the last 3.5 decades. I'm sure you guys all know where Siachen is, right? It's only those kids who don't know. While in the past, our lack of knowledge of our own army would have been shameful and sad, right now, it is suicidal. And let me tell you why. When I joined the army, I came from a fairly conventional background, a South Indian family, and we had this whole construct of jhoota, and you can't drink from someone else's cup or eat some from someone else's plate. And it was more to do with, I think, tradition rather than caste or discrimination, but you had a sense that you were different from the others. So imagine my shock that when I joined the army, we were given this one enamel mug. And that mug was your coffee mug, it was your shaving mug, it was your bathing mug, and it was your, every other mug. You got it. Then got a little worse because it's a regulation issue. So despite scratching your name on it, they would get interchanged. And so you could be drinking your coffee from someone else's every other mug. And that might sound weird to you. But for us, it was battle inoculation, because before you knew it, someone else's blood could be coursing through your veins. When a soldier is wounded, he doesn't really care whether he's getting the blood from a Christian, Muslim, Sikh, Jat, Maratha, it doesn't really matter. And that way, the Indian Armed Forces is an amazing place. For example, the first Sikh unit, the first Sikh battalion, is one of the oldest and the most decorated units of the Indian Armed Forces. This was the unit which was airlifted in October 1947 to stop the Pakistani Lashkars who were raiding Kashmir. And this was the unit which halted them at Srinagar. And it's thanks to this unit's gallant action that Kashmir is on the map of India. This unit of the finest Khalsa warriors is led by a Muslim commanding officer. And he leads them not only in battle, not only in exercises, he leads them in the Gurbani every day in the Gurdwara. Or take the case of Trija. In 1965 operations, they were tasked for one of the most difficult tasks, which was the capture of a location called Dogra. And that battle has gone down in the annals of Indian history as one of the most tough battles ever fought, because it was street to street, room to room, hand to hand. But Dogra was so pivotal for that operation that when their Anglo-Indian commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel Desmond Hayes, spoke to his men and explained to them the importance of that particular objective, He told them that we have to be in Dogarai by nightfall, dead or alive. And after giving them the briefing, he asked his Jat troops in his clipped Haryanvi, Susrai, aaj raat ko teen Jat kahan hogi? And the troops shouted back, Dogarai, Dogarai. He wanted to make sure that the troops understood that the mission was larger than the leader. Then he asked them, Oh Susrai, agar Shio saab ne goli laggi, to phir kya karoge? And without batting an eyelid, the senior Jeshua shouted back, Saab ji, agar Shio ne goli lagi, to kandhe pe taan ke le jayenge, lekin rukenge Dogarai jaake. And that night, in that operation, three Jat, consisting of Jat troops under an Anglo-Indian commanding officer, took back Dogarai not once but twice, winning 3 Mahavir Chakra, 4 Veer Chakras and 7 Sena medals in one single operation. Our soldiers don't fight. They don't care about the name on their chest, which is their own name. They care about the name on their shoulder, which is their Paltan's name. Once they join the unit, if they join a Gurkha unit, they become a Gurkha. If they join a Maratha unit, they become a Maratha. They become a band of brothers. They really don't care about caste, creed, gotras, religions and all of that stuff. And I think my sense is it's not just the army that feels that way. Some of you may remember in 1992, in Parvano, in the timber trail, there was this cable car which broke and it was dangling by a cable and there were many souls who were trapped inside it and they were going to plunge to certain death. There's a beautiful story of a Hindu woman who was trapped inside and she was praying to her gods to save her. And before a little while, they heard the thud of a chopper coming, the thud 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 of a Hepter coming in. And that Hepter was being flown by squadron leader Pali Major, who went on to become the Air Chief of the Indian Air Force. And from that Hepter, the para commando, first para commando unit, a legendary para commando, Captain Ivan Krasto, slithered down and entered into the cable car and saved the lives of the people inside. Now here's something really funny. This woman was reaching out to her Hindu gods, but it was a Christian para commando who came down, flown by a Parsi major, by a Parsi pilot. And we have seen this across the board when we are going for rescue into natural calamities or floods or even 2611. Neither the hostages, neither the people who have been rescued, nor the people who are rescuing really care about the religion, the caste, the creed, the composition of the troops who are coming to save. I don't know how many of you know this, that in our armed forces, we don't have any mandir, masjid, gurdwara. We have what is called a sarva dharm sthal, in which all the religions are prayed together. And a maulvi will do a pandit's job, pandit will stand in for a granthi. Somehow the gods don't seem to care either. But when this soldier comes back home, he gets a different world. He gets a completely different world. There is leaders, his political leaders, his religious leaders, his friends, his relatives tell him a different story. They tell him that that caste is stealing away jobs. This caste is taking away reservations. That person is different from you because he eats a different kind of meat. They tell him that you have to be our caste first and an Indian later. Ladies and gentlemen, soldiers don't fight with weapons. They fight on a moral high ground. Soldiers don't go into war because they hate the enemy in the front. They go to war because they love their countrymen in the back. Leaders across spectrums have their own agendas. Some people want to win elections, some people want to get more power, and some people genuinely want to do good for their own communities. But we, as citizens, have to realize one thing. That even as I'm speaking to you right now, standing over here, from Kanyakumari to Kargil, there are soldiers who are deployed in every kind of situation. Right now, as I speak to you, there is a captain out there in Siachen Glacier who is already battling 3 fronts. He has got a front of a very determined enemy. He has got a front of a very horrible weather which claims lives almost on a daily basis. And he's battling the front of the nonsense going on in Delhi with Jantar Mantar, with veterans fighting the government, government fighting the veterans. I beg of you, let's not open a fourth front for him. Let's not forget that the strength of this country which is symbolized by your armed forces, is the unity of its diversity. Let's not forget that. Jai Hind! Jai Hind!
One of the very few speakers has got a, what do you say, standing ovation on a TED talk. And one more kid asked him somewhere that why don't people join the army? It's a very valid question. What does the army teach you? So it's a 2-minute video. Just play that. And then we will go to the why I'm showing you these two videos to understand what I'm trying to tell. After seeing these videos, if you read the section, you will never forget it. So after seeing this video, don't you think so? Our armed forces deserve something? What do you think? Yes. So again, one lady asked, what are the reasons why we should join the army, which obviously most of us never join, never take. When you are doing your PUC, etc., did you ever think that you would want to join the army and all that? No. So that's one question that this girl asked.
Young people, the same person. There is a lack of willingness to join the army, or we do not have that thing for the army. Like, we are, we cannot relate to
your. Speak for yourself.
Yeah, for me. So, you know, can you motivate us for that, sir? Because among the youth, of all I know, we aspire to become doctors or chartered accountants or artists like that. But joining army is not a question that arises in our mind.
I would tend to disagree with you. There are a lot of people who want to join the army. That is there. That is true. But I also agree with you that the Indian Army, I don't know how many of you know, is facing a terrible shortage of officers. We don't have a shortage in men. Men we have, but officers we are facing a terrible shortage, and that's largely true to your point. You may sit down, please. You may sit down.
Yeah.
We are definitely facing a shortage, and that's because a lot of people have started equating material jobs. You know, you make much more money if you go and do an IAM and join a corporate, and yes, you don't join the army for money. But there are three reasons why you should think about joining the army. And I'm not talking about some national patriotic national anthem. That's not the point. The point is, there is no career in this world where you will lead as a 22, 23-year-old captain. You will have 200 men whose lives you will hold in your hands. You can be the president of any place, but you will not be able to take men into battle who will follow you because you are their leader, who lay down their life for you. That's never going to happen. You can pay as much of money as you want. You can give. We have to take men into battle without ESOP, pay hikes, employee of the month, or any one of those jamborees. Right? Now that's a form of leadership which no organization can teach you. No organization can teach you how to take men into certain deaths with your own personal charisma. That's it. You. That's it. And guess what? I don't know how many of you know this, that in the forces, there is no way I can give a bonus to a soldier who has done exceedingly well or cut the salary. There is no material tool. There is nothing. You have to lead with pure leadership, and no other career can teach you that. Secondly, to give you a little sense about my own career, and I'm just one of them. I'm sure hundreds and hundreds of people like me. I served in the army for about 11 years. Then I moved into the corporate world where I was a CEO for 3 different companies. And then I moved into the government to raise the national intelligence grid, which was set up after 26/11. And after 5 years, I've now moved back into the corporate. And I can tell you that every lesson, every marketing lesson, every communication lesson that I have ever learned, I learned in the army. We had to learn how to communicate when we were dropping out of aircrafts, where we were parachuting down. We had to know how to communicate with each other. So anything that you need to learn for a business, the root lies in warfare. Because what is business? It is nothing but more contenders contending for less resources. And that is the definition of war. So a lot of us don't realize that the origin of business, origin of communication, origin of logistics, every technology, radar, computers, internet, X-ray, television, sonar, even commercial aircrafts, they all originated from war. So why would you want to learn it secondhand in a B school when you can go to the root and learn it directly from the fountainhead? And I think if you understood that part, My sense is a lot of people will realize that even if you gave 10 years to the army would equip you for a much richer and a much more empowered life. The last piece I want to tell you, and this was a question that was asked earlier also in the panel discussion that we were having. A lot of us assume we are going to live forever. We do. That's why we postpone doing things that we want to do, postpone talking to somebody, postpone writing a mail, postpone karenge baad mein, this, that. That career teaches you why every day is a bonus and why every day has to be lived in technicolor. And that ability to experience life, think about it. Ask yourself this honest question, that suppose I took your life and filmed it with a 16 millimeter film. You remember the old digital films? Yeah. And I strung it in this hall in a string like this. And I took a pair of scissors and started cutting bits and pieces out of it and stuck it back together. You will not even notice the difference because one day was like another day was like another day. And so if I took out months and years from your life and you don't notice the difference, you might as well have not lived those years. In that career, you will live every day. Every day that you walk this planet will be a day that you will experience from the morning till evening as something that you will nourish. You will truly live life when you see death.
Yes, he said you will truly live life when you see death. So that's so true. Anyway, so tell me guys, now after all this that you have seen, don't you think so the armed forces deserve something? Yes. So they are telling, even now after this, if I ask you the question, how many of you would want to join? I still will not see any hands raised, because not that two videos will change your thinking or the way will inspire you to change your career. But at the end of the day, the least we can do, as I told you, out of 9,000 students, 9-10 students want to join. That doesn't mean the other 8,990 are weak. Now they are asking, as future chartered accountants, as CFOs or CEOs of companies, would you at least donate some money to the armed forces? Yes. Now, would that matter if something else is written in the articles? Should it matter? No. Articles say you should not give. Can you still give? Yes. MOA says you cannot give. Can you still give? Yes. Loan agreement. ICICI Bank has given you a loan. In the loan agreement, it says without the permission of ICICI, you cannot use it for any other purpose. Now, there is a war. You have taken a loan of 20 crores. Can you give full 20 crores to them? Yes. So the wordings of this section you will never see anywhere else. Check out the wordings. Now you will appreciate why this section was inserted. The board of directors of any company, this applies to any company that you can think of. No exemption, nothing. Any company or any person or authority exercising the powers of the board. Think about it, guys. Where have you seen such wordings? Remember, there were three directors, two directors resigned, there was only one director. What could he do? Appoint another person and then from there again go to EGM. Now, during such time, there is a war, unfortunately. Can that one person authorize the payment? Yes. Where have you seen such wordings? Never. Right? Any person or authority exercising the powers of the board of directors of a company or of the company in general meeting may, notwithstanding anything contained in section 180, that is, you know, the entire borrowing, investing and all that. For example, amount from amalgamation on merger, can I use it for donating to armed forces? Yes. Any resolution to be taken? No. 181, that is my bona fide and charitable funds. 182, political contribution. Or any other provision of this act or in the memorandum, articles or any other instrument relating to the company. Instrument, loan agreement. Example. Loan agreement says you cannot touch the money. There is a war now. Without asking anybody, I can do whatever I want with that money. No need to ask any nominee director, no one. Relating to the company, contribute such amount as it deems fit to the National Defense Fund or any other fund approved by the central government for the purposes of national defense. Every company shall disclose in its P&L account the total amount or amounts contributed by it to the fund referred to in section 1, subsection 1. Yes, they just need to disclose what they have taken, how much they have taken, etc. So as you can see, it is, you need to give back to your country. And the only thing, despite you probably may not join the armed forces, that's absolutely fine. Very few people have the guts and the gumption to actually do that. That doesn't mean you just sit there and eat money and not give something to the armed forces. Whether there is war or no war, can I still give it to the National Defense Fund? Yes. And have you seen any such wordings ever before? No. Board of any company or any other person or authority exercising the powers of the board. So whatever may be the strict legal position, if you have the power exercising the board, like you are a managing director who has been delegated by the board, or one director is there, all other directors have resigned. In the most, what do you say, problematic scenario for you, but still you can donate to the armed forces, because the rich, truly deserving people are them. So I always respected the Indian Army, but my perception of the army changed on it, what do you say, it kind of, the respect went beyond what was ever there before after I visited Kashmir. And I really saw with my own eyes what they do for our country. And this is just within our country. So think about the border areas. So that is the thing. So it's very easy for us to sit here and comment on them. So once we go there and see, we'll know the hard realities of life. So the least we can do is respect the armed forces. So sometimes here you may see that the army men will get everything free or everything at discounted rates. Army provision store is there. You may feel, why do they deserve it? They really deserve it. Because as I told you, my respect for army spouses also increased after meeting my friend and talking to my aunt. Because they said, I don't know whether today my colonel husband will come home in a body bag or alive. So think about it. When a person is going, it may be the last goodbye. So they are already attuned. They are already mentally trained to do so. But still, that is the soldiers. But think about the spouses. And they said the faster you realize that their first love was and always will be the country, then you will be at peace. They will never love you or your family more than the country. And that is something which is incredible. That is something which really requires complete suspension of your, you know, emotions and completely laying down your lives for the country. Now that is something which is incredible. For them, the least we can do is donate our mind. And mind you, this does not talk about profit making, 5% average profit, nothing. So can loss making company give donation? Yes. Are you getting it? The importance of the section, the wordings, you will never find any such wordings anywhere else in the Companies Act. Even a loss making company can give. If you see the previous 181, 5% of net profit. If it's a loss, what you will give? Correct? Nothing you can give. Bona fide and charitable funds, you are only are in need of charity now. Loss making company. But here, I'm heavy losses. Some money I have, 1000 rupees. Can I give? Yes. So it's a wonderful section. You would have never seen such wordings anywhere, notwithstanding anything contained in 180, 181, 182, or any other provision of this act. I could have simply explained this in 5 minutes, but you need to understand the history behind it. The person who actually wrote this law would have understood, or rather the group of people would have understood the importance of the armed forces. We are able to sleep well only because of them. If the borders are not guarded, then it is a different issue. So once in your life, please visit the beautiful place Kashmir and see for yourself how things are, and also appreciate the beauty. It is no less than inland Switzerland. I liked it more than Switzerland actually. But the thing is, unfortunately, because of the issues, no one visits there. Our own country people don't visit there. After Pulwama attack, forget about foreigners. Indian companies only, Indian people only, our Indians itself, they cancelled the attack. Sri Lanka is such a beautiful country, after a terrorist attack, wiped out. You are getting 5-star hotels at 80%, 90% off. 5-star hotel which costs 40,000 rupees per day, they are charging 4,000 rupees now. Gone. The Sri Lanka, Kashmir, they all thrive on hospitality and tourism. And if you from your own country don't support India, then who will? So that's why I'm saying, please, once in your life go, you will change as a person and come when you go there. You will see the beauty of the warmth of the people, extremely hospitable. They don't have anything with them, but still when you go and say, I just need one kahwa or kehwa, that's their tea. They will give you, they'll make and give, and if you actually pay them money, they will get so offended. they'll get so offended. Very normal, small, poor people, poor person's house you go, extremely impoverished person, you just tell, I want some tea, I've come from Bangalore, I've come from other parts of the country, can I have some tea? That's it. So they will do anything to make you feel hospitable despite having no money. So the least we can do for our armed forces is this. This is the gist of the section. So with this we finish the entire cluster. 182 we'll link it with MD provisions. So we'll take a break. After the break we will do the questions on the entire cluster. Right? We'll finish it off. You have many questions. Every